set my feet upon the sea till I'm dancing in the deep. Oh, peace be still, you are.
voice, declare it now. Jesus Christ is Lord. And with a shout, the walls come down. Lift every voice, declare it now. Jesus Christ.
With you some words, some descriptions, a portrait, if you will, that was painted by the Apostle Paul. He said, Christ is the visible image of the invisible God. He existed before anything was created and is supreme over all creation. For through him, God created everything in the heavenly realms and on earth. He made the things we can see and the things we can't see, such as thrones, kingdoms, rulers, and authorities in the unseen world. Everything was created through him and for him. He existed before anything else, and he holds all creation together. Christ is also the head of the church, us, which is his body. He's the beginning, supreme over all who rise from the dead, and he is therefore justly called the Lord of all. For God in all his fullness was pleased to live in Christ, and through him God reconciled everything to himself. He made peace with everything in heaven and on earth, by means of Christ's blood on the cross. Now, as we ponder all of that, it makes me wonder, okay, who is that really about? Who does all of that greatness describe? Johnny has written a song that will help us answer that. As we learn it together, the students have been singing it all weekend. And the only real answer to those questions Paul gave to us, no one else but Jesus could be and is all of that greatness. So let's worship no one but Jesus.
What God takes time to build, no one but Jesus. And what God our hearts would fill, no one but Jesus. And what God would speak to me, save, who can free us from bondage, whose name
delivers his people from shame, who reshapes all our failures and turns them to wins for his fame. No one but Jesus. One man empowers the weak. No one but Jesus.
Take my life and sacrifice.
done and not my strength. But yours alone and nothing else. But you, oh Lord, I find everything in you, not my way.
Guys, as you're being seated, take your Bibles, your smart device, whatever it is, you follow along, and let's look at Matthew's Gospel, chapter 13. This is the third week in our series on the gospel in the crowd, Jesus' interaction with the crowds. We began with his conversations with individuals, and then we looked at his conversations with the religious leaders, and that series was the problem with religion, and now we're looking at the gospel in the crowd, his exchanges with the crowds, his teachings of the crowds, and we'll follow that up with his conversations and teachings to his disciples. Let me piggyback on Josh's welcome. Say thank you for being here this morning. Our disciple now took place this weekend. Thank you, all of you that had such a vital role in making this a reality, our guest homes, our leaders, those that provided snacks, prayers, your involvement. This truly is a church-wide endeavor, so we're grateful for that. You will notice that in this week's passage that Jesus says something that he did on the previous two messages we looked at, the two previous occasions we looked at, where after Jesus addressed the crowd, he closed with these very same words that we see here in verse 9 of Matthew chapter 13. He says, "He who has ears, let him hear." The meaning is that it's your responsibility to hear. It's your responsibility to listen. It's your responsibility to figure out what it is that God is saying through you whenever his word is being taught, whenever his word is being proclaimed. That's your responsibility, no one else's. And so Jesus speaks to the crowd with the reality that out of a crowd there are going to be disciples that will emerge, that will come forth. He knew that there's a difference between the church and the crowd. Crowd does not constitute a church. Disciples constitute the church. So anytime Jesus addressed the crowd, his words were always a challenge. You need to listen to this. It's not going to have a broad-based appeal. You need to listen very carefully. Because out of you, the crowd, there is going to be those that would emerge called disciples that will in fact be the church. And so he's saying to us that you really need to listen. You're responsible for listening and hearing. Well, what is it on this occasion that Jesus wants the crowd to hear? What does he want us to hear? What does he want us to listen to? Well, it's a parable that's very familiar. Let me just pick it up here in verse 1. It says, "That day, Jesus went out of the house." There's kind of a missional message here for us as well. This may be a whole different message that I do entirely. But Jesus went out of the house. Says to us that the church, that Jesus, that the gospel is not homebound. That what we are supposed to be about is the church, the body of Christ, entrusted with the word of God, entrusted with the gospel. What we do, our mission cannot be accomplished in here. Can't be accomplished in the house. The people of God are not a housebound people. We are a people that go out into the world. So Jesus went out from the house, didn't stay in the house, holler at everybody, hey, if you're interested, you come here where I am. Jesus went out and engaged the crowd, went out, engaged the masses, engaged his culture in conversation, in meaningful dialogue about the things of God. So he went out, and large crowds gathered around him. So he got into a boat and sat down, and the whole crowd was standing on the beach. And he spoke many things to them in parables, saying, behold, the sower went out to sow. Now, that's very unusual right there. That's really not a job title. Our farmers that are here, our cotton farmers or any kind of farmer, you don't hire sowers. Sowing is something that a farmer does, but it's among the myriad of things that a farmer has to do. Sowing is just one part. Right, guys? Nobody goes out and hires exclusively sowers. That's just something that's part of what farmers do. But what it says to us is that what Jesus is about, he's about sowing. The church is about sowing the Word of God. We are entrusted with the Word of God. We are entrusted with the gospel. The primary responsibility of the church is to be a people who go out and we sow the Word of God. Church has to do some other things, but everything else the church does, listen, everything else that the church has to do that is secondary to the primary task of being a people who go out and sow the word. And so Jesus, or this sower, the story that he tells, he goes out to sow, and as he sowed, and envision this, this is a very pictorial message. And as he sowed, some seeds fell beside the road, and birds came and ate them up. Others fell on the rocky places where they did not have much soil, and immediately they sprang up because they had no depth of soil. But when the sun had risen, they were scorched, and because they had no root, they withered away. Others fell among the thorns, and the thorns came up and choked them out. And others fell on the good soil and yielded a crop, some 100-fold, some 60, and some 30. He who has ears to hear, let him hear. In other words, he's saying, don't miss what I've said to you. Listen closely. Imagine everything that I have just described to you. Now, listening is hard. I get it. Listening is challenging. And this is probably this format that we're in right now is probably the least effective form of teaching, communication, where you sit and I stand up here. That's not a very effective form of teaching. But there is something about the proclaimed word that has been effective for the past 2,000 years. But listening really is an acquired skill. When you're intentional about listening, you get better at it. But I understand the challenge of being where you are and having to listen to me for 25 minutes. That's challenging. It takes great deliberateness, intentionality to listen, to anticipate what maybe the Holy Spirit is saying to you in your heart, in your life, in your season, in your station, where you are, and how you walk out of here and how you apply this to your life. I get it. Larry Barker wrote a book about communication. He's a communications expert. And he wrote this book entitled Listening Behavior, and he talks about our different orientations when it comes to listening. Each one of us have a style of listening. For instance, some people are, he writes about these four different orientations. There's people-oriented listening. And these are people that when they're listening to you, when they're telling the story, there's not too much that you can tell them. Those who are people-oriented listeners, they want to hear your story, but they also want to know why you're communicating to them, why you're talking to them. They want to know what the temperature was that day. This story you're telling, what was the temperature outside? You know, if you're telling a story about walking up the street, they want to know, were you going north, south, east, or west? People-oriented. Now, others then that he describes are what he calls action-oriented. They listen with the anticipation of having to offer a response. What do you need me to do? I'm not really interested in details. Just tell the part of the story that I need to know so that I can take action. I can respond. See, a lot of this in marriage. I mean, I'm a very action-oriented listener. Patty is a very people-oriented listener. And so I found myself early on in marriage. We've both gotten, after 30 years, we've both gotten a lot better at this. She's better at telling stories. I'm better at listening. Because used to, and early on in our marriage, I mean, she would start telling these stories. You know, I went to the mall. You'll never guess who I saw. Never believe what they were wearing. You won't, it was so cute. And you start getting all these ancillary stories that don't matter. So she would be talking, and I'd be saying, I'd go, oh, come on. And I would start going like this. I said, just jump to the part where you need me to do something. Well, and she's gotten better at communication. She now knows that I'm more action-oriented, so when she communicates to me, she just tells me the part I need to know. Saves the other ancillary parts for somebody else that's more people-oriented. There's another kind of orientation when it comes to listening that Barker alludes to, and that's content listening, content-oriented in listening. This is something that those of you that work at Texas Tech, LCU, that work in higher education, you have to adjust to be a content-oriented listener. Higher education loves meetings. The academy loves meetings. When I served as a chairman of an academic affairs committee one occasion, I sit in there, and the first thing that shocked me, sitting on an academic affairs committee dealing with those in higher education, was how inefficient this operation is. My first thought was, no business could survive like this. No church, no organization. The academy alone is an animal unto itself. I called it it's just meetings after meetings after meetings. Nothing ever gets done. It's this incredible intellectual capacity that just shares ideas. I call it the cul-de-sac of ideas. They live in a world that is a cul-de-sac of ideas. That's the nature of education, higher education. And then there's time-oriented listening. I need just enough information to make a timely-oriented decision about something. Listening is an acquired skill. And too often, we quit listening too soon. We quit listening too fast. A retired internist by the name of Richard Linger, he's an academician, he had a private practice. He wrote an article in the Journal of Internal Medicine, said as an internist, as he looked back over the course of his career, he said, on those occasions where I misdiagnosed something, he said, without fail, it was because I stopped listening too soon. He said, maybe I had a certain number on a day of clinics. He said, maybe I had a certain number of people I wanted to see that morning. Patient starts talking to me. And he said, I quit listening too soon. And when I quit listening too soon, I ended up making a misdiagnosis. Well, I hope you'll allow me this morning. I want to be a diagnostician. And I want to borrow from the words of Jesus. And I want to compel you, if you have ears to hear this morning. Because as a diagnostician, as an under-shepherd, I have a concern that when it comes to the Word of God, the teaching of the Word of God, the hearing of the Word of God, there is such a familiarity with it that we quit listening too soon. And when you quit listening too soon to the Word of God, there's a very real possibility that you make the wrong response. Because when it comes to the Word of God, its teaching, its proclamation, the purpose of it isn't just to give you new information, but to create new life. But if you don't get that, if you're not seeking that, you can make a wrong response to the Word of God. Because there's only one right response. There's really only one response that makes a difference. There's only one that leads to eternal life. There's only one that will transform your life and give it meaning and purpose right now. Because what we see in the beginning of this is a series of wrong responses. Because what Jesus alludes to first is you see the farmer who's dropping who just loses some seed there on the ground, on the side of the road. Some people just have an indifferent response when it comes to the Word of God. That's really what he's describing here in verse 3 and 4, where it says, behold, the sower went out to sow, and as he sowed, some seeds fell beside the road, and the birds came and ate them up. Jesus gives a little bit more explanation to each one of these further in the chapter. For instance, if you look at verse 19, it says, when anyone hears the word of the kingdom and does not understand it, the evil one comes and snatches away what has been sown in his heart. This is the one on whom seed was sown beside the road. That is the walking path. It's a life that's not really conducive. It's not really prepared. They're not even looking for the things of God. It's a kind of, it receives the activity of men, this worn path on the side of the road. It receives the activity of men, that is walking feet. It receives the activity of men, but it doesn't receive the activity of God. Worries more about the opinions of men. It seeks its opinion on a variety of social issues. It seeks after the voice of other authorities, not the word of God. And there's a kind of indifference to the things of God. It goes in one ear and out the other. It doesn't really connect. It doesn't really fire. There's no real anticipation of what God, through the power of the Holy Spirit, is going to say to you through the proclamation and the teaching of the word of God. There's no real anticipation of how my life is going to be transformed because I've been here, because I've heard it, that I'm going to be different when I walk out than when I came in. Apathy, indifference. And if you were raised in church, that's the biggest battle you face. If you were raised in church, that's the biggest battle you face. Because that's what jumped out to me as a 21-year-old college student who came to faith in Christ, never had been inside a church before, and I come in as a newborn believer in Christ Jesus, 21-year-old college student. The biggest thing that impacted me when I came into the life of church, I thought everyone was going to be as fired up as I was. I thought that everyone else's conversion experience was as drastic as mine was, that they were that hungry, that they were that passionate. But what I was confronted with, what hit me in the face, was apathy and indifference. And it's primarily because most of those that are in attendance grew up in church. And it breeds this kind of familiarity where you really don't think about it. You just take it for granted that you hear the word of God taught and preached. And you get to this dangerous place where it just doesn't fire, just doesn't connect. Listen, the gospel of Jesus Christ, listen, church, the gospel of Jesus Christ knows nothing about indifference. There is no model of biblical faith that is portrayed with apathy and indifference. None. And so we see in here that a wrong response is apathy and being indifferent to the things of God. But Jesus also had to deal with an emotional response. The sower also saw these responses that were emotional in nature. It says in verses 5 and 6, others fell on the rocky places where they did not have much soil. You had a thin layer of topsoil there in Palestine on top of this limestone. Oh, it looked attractive. It looked appealing. But when the sun had risen, they were scorched. And because they had no root, they withered away. Jesus further describes that in verse 20, where it says, the one on whom seed was sown on the rocky places, this is the man who hears the word of God and immediately, the first blush response, immediately receives it with joy. Oh, there's enthusiasm, there's emotion, there's feeling, there's passion. That's the initial response. Yet he has no firm root in himself, but is only temporary. That knee-jerk reaction, that emotional response, that rush of emotion, just temporary. See, the most qualifying characteristic, the most identifying characteristic of a disciple of Jesus Christ, you hear me say this often, is what? They endure to the end. There's nothing temporary about biblical faith. True faith endures to the end, but not this. This is temporary, and when affliction or persecution arises because of the word, immediately he falls away. So these are individuals who are hearing the gospel. They, you know, maybe they heard it from Maybe they heard it from a very charismatic person, very charismatic personality. They were attracted to that. I mean, we live in a day and time that is drawn to the cult of personality. I hear it among college graduates, young adults who move off to Dallas, Atlanta, Houston, wherever. And if I run into them, I say, hey, you found a church home yet? Oh, yeah, I go to so-and-so's church. And they name a name. They don't tell you the name of the church. They tell you the name of the personality. It's a cult of personality. And when you're drawn to personalities in the life of faith, it doesn't endure. It doesn't persevere. Or maybe you were at a Disciple Now. Maybe you were at a youth camp or something. Amen. All your friends around you, they were going to the front, and you want to go down to the front with your girlfriend because she's so emotional, and you get emotional. Oh, it's this wonderful little sentimental moment. But listen, emotion validates nothing. That you had an emotional response when you first heard the gospel, that validates nothing. You can be emotional about a lot of things, but it doesn't validate that the experience was real, that it was genuine. The thing about emotion, if that is your touchstone, if that is your reference point, well, my life may not reflect my commitment to Jesus Christ now, but I know that was real back then. Man, when I was in sixth grade, I'll never forget going down that aisle. I was with three of my friends, and we were all crying. Oh, it was so emotional. Now, whatever that was an emotional experience, no doubt. But if it's not being played out in the reality of who you are right now, and if it doesn't continue to the end, whatever that was, definitely emotional, just wasn't a saving experience. It wasn't a new birth in Christ Jesus. And the problem with emotion, and listen, we all have different type personalities. Some are more emotional, some are more demonstrative, others are more reflective, cerebral. I get that. But the problem with basing your faith of experience upon emotion is that if you're always chasing the buzz, if you're always looking for the next emotional buzz and feeling, you're just going to be bebopping around. Well, this place used to give me a buzz. It doesn't give me a buzz anymore. If dancing bears attracted you to a church, if dancing bears attracted you to a place, you're the type of person that is always going to be bouncing around, never putting down roots, because you're always going to need bigger and better dancing bears to keep you. So there's emotional responses. There's apathetic responses. But there's another one that Jesus speaks to, and I call it a secular response. In all of these responses that Jesus is describing in the parable of the sower, all of them are here this morning. All of them are in every crowd. They're in every church in America this morning, every one of these. But the secular response is probably the most prevalent in our churches today. Listen to how Jesus describes this. In verse 7, he says, "Others fell among the thorns, and then the thorns came up and choked them out." That's very powerful language, the idea of things choking out the word of God. He describes it further here in verse 22. "And the one on whom seed was sown among the thorns, this is the man who hears the word, and the worry of the world and the deceitfulness of wealth." Man, do we need to hear that in this country, in our society, in our economy. "And the deceitfulness of wealth choke the word, and the result is that it becomes unfruitful." Started out looking pretty good. Started out looking pretty convincing, but as they grew in affluence, as their financial capacity increased, well, there was a corresponding decrease in their hunger and their thirst for the Word of God and its input in their life. Ronald Snyder borrowed from a popular book title and wrote a book himself called The Scandal of the Evangelical Conscience. And one of the things that jumped out of that book in my reading was that he actually took some statistics and did a comparison of the lifestyle and the social behaviors, the social sins, if you will, the social behaviors, social sins of professing Christians, and compared them to their secular, non-professing, non-religious, secular counterparts. And the statistics revealed that the professing church actually performed worse than our secular counterparts, especially in the area of consumer debt. It's like competing throne rooms in our life. Do I want more of the things this world has to offer, or do I want more the things that the kingdom of God has to offer? And it seems that American Christians are always trying to find a way to make these things compatible, that they can cohabitate with one another, and they can't. Not according to the gospel. They're mutually exclusive. But something happens in the minds of American believers. How often do you hear American Christians talk about the word blessing? The only time they ever talk about blessing is when they ever experience some financial windfall. Experience financial windfall, oh, God just blessed me. Really? You really think that's it? You more so than our brothers or sisters in Christ in socialist countries or dictatorships that really don't even have an economy driven by capitalism? You really think this is God preferring you over somebody else? And it's in financial form. It's kind of a uniquely American way of framing things, isn't it? But we have a way of doing that in our affluence in this culture, trying to take the gospel and to fashion it into something that fits in comfortably with the lifestyle that we've already chosen to live for ourselves. And Jesus gives this warning that wealth and prosperity has a way of choking out the word. And people of ever-increasing financial capacity, we seem to have this uncanny knack for dealing with stewardship according to our own rules instead of the Word of God. Because what happens to people of incredible financial capacity is interesting. I was serving on a board of a university on one occasion. And I've shared some stories with you before about those unique persons and people of incredible financial capacity. In the break time, they'll talk to me, Bob, you ever heard of this ministry? And they always want to name some parachurch ministry. Bob, you ever heard of this ministry? I'm on their board. I'm involved with them. No, I never heard of it. You know, my personality is such, even if I'd heard of it, I'd tell them no. Nope, never heard of it. Well, I serve on their board. And you ask them, tell me about your church. They don't ever have anything to say about the church. And it's a uniquely American phenomenon that for people of incredible financial capacity, the church is too small for their ego. That's how they get interested in parachurch organizations. They fall for the flattery of parachurch organizers. I'm going to give you, I need you. I need your input. No, they really need your money. And they make you feel special. You fall for their flattery. You know, the thing about all these outside organizations, you know, the church only has one revenue stream. The church only has one revenue stream, and that's the people of God. We're not like other foundations. We're not like a university. We're not like a business. We don't have multiple revenue streams for the church. The church has one revenue stream. That's the people of God, disciples, followers of Jesus Christ, who have a vested interest in the life of the church of the Lord Jesus Christ. But if we're not careful, you read my devotional this morning, it says, watch yourselves. Because if we don't watch ourselves, we can start to think everything is about ourselves. Watch yourselves, make sure you stay faithful to the things of God, because what happens with increasing financial capacity, it can choke out the word of God and think that we can arrange a life that is to be played according to our rules and not his. So we can have a secular response, we can have an emotional response, you can have an apathetic response to the things of God, but there's only one that matters. Notice a transformational response in what it looks like. This is a legit biblical response to the Word of God. This is a saving response, a transformational, redeeming response to the Word of God. This is what it looks like. He says in verse 8, and others fell on the good soil and yielded a crop. It yielded a crop. There you go. Some 100-fold, some 60, and some 30. He who has ears, let him hear. Greater detail in verse 23, and the one on whom seed was sown on the good soil, this is the man who hears the word of God and understands it. Who indeed bears fruit and brings forth. The last two verbs of this parable. Bears fruit and brings forth. Bears fruit and produces. Bears fruit and does things. Now don't misunderstand me. I'm not saying you do things to get your salvation, but he says salvation does things. True salvation does things. True salvation bears fruit. And that's the Holy Spirit working in you. That is your salvation being worked out when Christ Jesus is in you. When you've experienced the new birth, born again in Christ Jesus, you're a different person. You have been transformed by the power of your spirit, by the power of God's spirit. And that spirit of the resurrected Christ is working himself out of you. He's laboring, working, striving to get out of you, to produce fruit. The older I get, the simpler it gets. The fruit of the Spirit, Galatians 5:22, is love, joy, peace, patience, kindness, goodness, faithfulness, gentleness, self-control. Against such things, there is no law. That's not an exhaustive list. It's things that the Spirit, that the resurrected Christ is trying to work out of us that shows that we're something different. Conversion bears fruit in your life. It doesn't generate indifference. It's not something that was just emotional 10 years ago that has no impact on your life today. If you were truly saved then you're saved now, and you'll be saved in the future, and that will continually manifest itself over the course of your life. That's it in a nutshell. You know, the thing is, all four of these are here. And all four of these would profess to being Christian. These are unchristian Christians. Three out of the four are unchristian Christians. I mean, there's none of these here that are repulsed by the Word of God. No one in this narrative is repulsed by the blood of God. There's no one in this story that has evil intentions when they hear the word of God. These are all probably professing Christians. But there's only one that's legit. And it's the one that brings about transformation of life. Now, Jesus uses a powerful image here when he says they bear fruit and it brings forth some 100-fold, some 60, and some 30. That's not hyperbole. That's reality. He's talking about maximizing your potential, maximizing your possibilities. It's not exaggeration. He's not using hyperbole there with these numbers like he does in other places and in the gospel. Forgive someone 70 times 7. That's hyperbole. This is not hyperbole. The average yield of a single grain in Palestine, the average yield was 35 seeds. An individual grain in Palestine, average yield 35 seeds, sometimes 60. And in exceptional cases, it would bear forth 100 seeds. Jesus is saying to the crowd, if you really want to maximize your possibilities of what you are created to be, If you really want to maximize the possibilities of what God can do in your life, when you give yourself over to the pursuit of Him, it's going to maximize it. It's going to multiply your capabilities 30, 60, 100 times. It's unlimited. When you really start chasing after this, three out of the four, unchristian Christians. Unchristian individuals who profess to be Christian, but they're not. Because they're indifferent. All they can point to is something that is emotional. Truth is, the secular world has choked out the Word of God, and the transformation process is not happening. Judas sold Jesus for 30 pieces of silver. Sold his soul for 30 pieces of silver. What are you selling him for? Are you selling him and you selling your soul trying to be someone who fits in with the crowd? Are you selling him so that the crowd will be impressed? Are you selling him for a place of power, for a place of prestige? Exchanging him for wealth? Don't let your soul go to pot. It's a parable of introspection. It's a parable of self-analysis. It's not one you listen to and say, I hope so-and-so is listening. Because the reality is, every one of us has seasons in our life where we're apathetic, where we're indifferent. Where we have emotional responses that really have no impact on our life. We've all been there, done that. But are you really chasing after the things of God? Are you really listening? Are you really listening to what the Holy Spirit is saying in your ear, in your heart, in your mind right now? Who's really listening? Father, I pray that as we come to our time of decision, that we each one would examine our own hearts and our own lives. Father, it's so easy to fall into patterns of religious behavior. It's so easy to fall into patterns of just being satisfied with being here, just getting up and going to church, that we don't really have any anticipation of what being here is going to do and accomplish in our lives. Father, might we all be honest and real with ourselves this morning in our relationship with you. Does our commitment to the Lordship of Jesus Christ, is that truly reflected in the person, in the people that we are? Is it the passionate pursuit of our hearts and our lives? Is it truly the DNA of who we are? Is it the fabric of our identity? Father, might we be honest with ourselves so that we can be honest with you. Father, for those that have never committed their life to you, I pray that this would be the morning and the opportunity and the moment right now when they would answer that call that you put forth to follow me. We know that voice rings in our heart and our mind every day, follow me. And I pray, Lord, for those that today need to take that first step on this lifelong journey of the passionate pursuit of Jesus Christ and Him crucified, Him resurrected, Him exalted. That today purpose might be discovered in the newness of that relationship that you would desire to have with us. In Jesus' name I pray, amen.
For more information, give us a call or visit us online at firstlubbock.org. Check out our other worship times, Sundays at 8:15 or 11 a.m. Experience these online or come visit us at Broadway and Avenue V in Lubbock. Download our mobile app to experience even more from First Lubbock. Thanks for watching. God bless and have a great week.